So it's I really have a great pleasure in providing this overview. The talk won't be much technical. Instead, we will overview a few topics that we've been dealing with in the last 30 years or so. Just for the fun, I wanted to know how I ranked in the co-authors of Jack, and I'm pretty low. You see, with only 41 publications shared with Jack as a co-author.
So I'm not sure you will see your slide, Yves.
Yeah, it's not moved on from the front slide.
Okay. Let me... It's not moving on. Let me try another...
Now we see it. Yeah.
Oh, okay, so is it okay? I will not use the full screen mode. Okay. So do you see it? This beautiful list with Stan and Piotr as the top co-authors of Jack? Okay, that was just for the record. So the story started, I think, the first work we did together with Jack were very long ago in 96. We were dealing with redistribution routines. So at that time, the cyclic and block cyclic and block distributions were only starting to be studied. And we came to understand very quickly that cyclic was good for load balancing, but bad for communications, while full block was the contrary, very good for communication, very few communication, but a great imbalance. So we had to invent the cyclic of R trade-off. And then, of course, different applications having different requirements. We did not want the same R. So we had to move from a cyclic of 2 to cyclic of 10 or whatever. So redistribution were needed. So here is the problem. Here you have 6 processors and the array, which is distributed as a cyclic of 2, 1D. Array should be moved onto a cyclic tree array. And at that time, the only tool we had was the Scalapack caterpillar, where, you know, like a caterpillar, pairs of exchanges were programmed at each step. So we decided we could do better, and we realized that not every processor was communicating to every processor. And more importantly, that the messages sent were not on the same side. So we had to be careful and, how to put it, extract perfect matchings from the communication graph between senders and receivers. And this work has been very successful and has led to several papers. And it was very fun because a lot of teams at that time were dealing with that problem. So there were a lot of competing efforts to solve this redistribution problem. Interestingly enough, we revisited this problem not so long ago, maybe 10 years ago, with an additional degree of complexity. So you see here, you are given a matrix and whose data is not distributed as you would like it to be. So for instance, you want to do a matrix multiplication and you need the data to be 2D block cyclic, but here the data is random. So you have to redistribute if you want to implement your favorite gem with a 2D block cyclic. And not only you have to redistribute, but you have to choose which processor is which on the 2D grid you are going to build. And of course, because of the locality of communications and stuff, it really matters to decide for the permutation in the grid. So the problem is much more complex. And also, you can also ask yourself, do I really need to redistribute? Why shouldn't I try and perform my matrix multiply or LU or QR with the data in place? So this led to a bunch of very nice algorithmic problems, which we revisited 10 years ago. So here is a motivation from the application side. You have a satellite and the data is queued and your matrix is not at all, I mean, it's not purely random, but it's not at all a 2D block cyclic. Okay, that was one of the first problems. Let me move to the bunch of what we did. So linear algebra. So I remember vividly this problem. It was before 2000. And I was talking with Jack, and Jack told me, you know, Yves, you should try and look at heterogeneous platforms. And I answered Jack, really, Jack, you're not kidding. Do you think they have any future? And Jack said, yes, I think they do. And he convinced me very easily, and the other guys around, that we should augment the Scalapack routine with features suited to heterogeneous platforms. So here again, it was a wise decision, because the future proved, of course, that heterogeneous platform had a very big impact on computing. And the algorithmic problems were amazingly fascinating. Here is the simplest one. You have a homogeneous 3x4 grid. And if you want to transform it into a heterogeneous grid, say you do a gem, intuitively the size of the area owned by the processor should be proportional to its speed. And so you have a nice tiling or partitioning problem. And of course, you are not restricted to 2D grid. You can envision different partitioning rules from the simplest 1D to the maybe more challenging, completely unconstrained. And there are load balancing issues. There are communication issues. So altogether, it has kept us busy for several years. I would say 4 to 5 years to fully understand the problem. And of course, GEM is simpler than LU because the matrix shrinks as the elimination progresses. So you have to add an additional level of balancing on the fly. In passing, we also revisited, referring to Jim Stock and the famous Loomis-Whitney bound, we revisited it and improved Toledo algorithms for matrix multiply, deriving a new algorithm and a new bound. But we had a gap in between, which Julien Langoux improved a few years ago, and which finally Jim and Thorsten and many others have kept improving and studying. Okay, then came the time for QR. So this is because of the, driven by the advent of multi-core processors, we realized that we could do a QR better. So the traditional QR algorithm was very regular and nicely, smoothly, I should say, pipeline. You all know it. The greedy or binary tree was much more aggressive, starting elimination in several locations, so several killer rows or elimination rows in parallel. And then, of course, pipelining was a little more challenging. And we came up with a very complex and sophisticated algorithm, which was a mix of everything, main killers per processors, local killers inside the processors. That was very interesting to study. And I think this is still one of the most powerful and efficient implementation that is available for QR. Continuing, we are closer to today now. This is a very interesting problem we studied, an algorithm we tried to invent. We had a student, Julien Herman, and we were complaining that LU was so efficient and so easy to parallelize, while the QR was twice as costly and more difficult to pipeline. So Jack came up with the idea to mix both. So basically, you are at a given elimination step, and you consider whether you should do LU or QR to factorize the column block. So what we propose is we try and do part of the LU, get some estimate on the, I don't, how can I put it, on the condition number of the matrix, and try to guess whether it is stable enough to do LU or whether we should resort to QR. Then we involve the Julien Langlois to help us analyze the stability and the growth of the size of the coefficient, well, the classical study that Nick would have done. And we came up with this very complicated algorithm where we try LU, and if it works, we proceed, and if it doesn't, we roll back and implement QR. Maybe it's too complicated because after our publication in JPDC, I have not seen many papers trying to use this algorithm. Anyway, it was a nice mix of several worlds. This is much more recent, just to tell you that we can continue to play with matrix multiplication on Summit at the time. So this is, of course, as you know, a very large distributed machine, but the nodes are very interesting. They are equipped with 6 GPUs, and the GPUs, they can talk to each other through special links. There are 3 on one side and 3 on the other side. So there are many, many ways to optimize data locality. And it turns out that the link between the main memory and the GPUs is the bottleneck. So we should really control the data that goes through this link. So it's kind, if you wish, like the old out-of-core algorithm revisited for the sake of GPUs. So we decide that each GPU has a, well, the matrix is as a 2D block cyclic, as usual. The GPU, they have a round-robin assignment. And then instead of, you tile the blocks of the matrix like everybody does since Toledo. And then you further have to segment the update of a given block, because otherwise the tiles don't fit in the GPUs and there are other tiles that are ready. So the software would like to fetch them in and you don't want that. So you add a lot of control and you end up with a powerful algorithm. Let me skip everything. And the last example I have for linear algebra is this one. It's the same problem, but with matrices that tensors. So the tiles are heterogeneous and some tiles are void, are zero. So the matrix is block sparse. And then you have to do, basically you have to do the same stuff, but in a more complex and refined way, because the load balancing is much more difficult to achieve and data reuse is much more limited because of the sparsity. So that's really what we've been busy recently at ICL. Okay. I think I'm okay without time, but I need to proceed. So for resilience, I won't say, I won't cover what we did a lot of things. You know, as you say, as we say, scale is the enemy because if you have very robust computing resources that fail every 10 years, if you add up 100 thousands of them, you have a failure every hour. So you need to augment all the linear algebra algorithms with resilience or fault tolerance strategies. And we studied many at ICL. I don't want to list what we did, but you can find all our papers. So let me say a few words about life at ICL, because this is today's topic. I personally came to know Jack a long time ago. It turns out we shared an office at the IBM European Center for Scientific Computing that was located in Rome, Italy. That was a beautiful place to be. Unfortunately, IBM has closed it a long time ago. And I spent a year in exile after Bernard Touranchot and Frédéric Després did the same and reported very good news about Noxville. At the time also, Jack had his first French PhD student, Antoine Petitet and Henri Casanova. So there was a nice team there. As many of you have mentioned already, Sue was very important and a wonderful hostess. And we have so nice souvenirs. Here is Antoine Petitet with Jack. Oops, sorry. That's me living with Antoine. This one is, I don't know where it is. And then I came to ask myself, what is it that is so special at ICL? Because I'm working at LIP, the computer science lab at INS Lyon, and it is a very nice place to work, very friendly. But it has, since the beginning with Michel Kostner, it has grown a lot, and there are several topics addressed. So it really lacks its. There are two things that should characterize ICL at my in my eyes. That is the family atmosphere with the family patriarch, Jack, taking care of everybody and really being always present every time somebody has a problem, be it administrative or personal. And also it has this unique atmosphere of being centered around HPC, which makes, and for a lab of this size, it is very, very big size, a very big number of people all working towards HPC. So altogether, combining this unicity of topic and this friendly atmosphere, it's really a unique place to be. And the French mafia has been invading ICL. Piotr would say that. In those very nasty words. Many of us from every city of France have been visiting ICL and spending from a few weeks to years. And there is a reason to that. This is really that Jack is making, I can't distinguish Jack and ICL and the whole lab. It is really his achievement as a community. And I really would like to thank him for that and to wish him a very, very good birthday today. Thank you very much.